Again, I didn't really sleep last night. I don't think I've had a restorative night's sleep in long farther than I can remember, but I went to bed so happy. You know, Phil Lesh and friends were playing down in Las Vegas, and two of my brothers were at the show, and I treated myself to buying an HD stream of it, and wow, they just played all these songs that brought back so many memories, and my sleepless nights are full of memories, right? And, you know, you hear about insomnia, about how you should put that to use, and I do, and I make arts and crafts projects when I should be fucking sleeping, right? And then I toss and turn and toss and turn, and then finally, it's 1 in the afternoon, 2 in the afternoon, and listening to Phil sing, "We bid you goodnight, I love you, but Jesus loves you the best, and we bid you goodnight, goodnight, goodnight," and then "Broke Down Palace," and all these songs that mean so much to me, right? And so happy, yet I tossed and turned and tossed and turned. The night before, my dreams were filled with my dad. And maybe it's the thought of all the Easter and all the religious dogma that goes along with it, which I don't really buy into. But I couldn't help but thinking that resurrection happens in a way that we don't expect it to. My dad is in me and in my brothers and in my nieces and nephews. But still, I don't sleep. Last night, I found myself going through all those postcards I'd been mailing out, and I had taken little crappy snapshots of them and cropping them and uploading them. Useless tasks. And then that means I'm looking at a screen, which isn't healthy for me, right? But, I don't want to watch television. I'm not a television watcher. I'm that guy who's never seen Breaking Bad or Game of Thrones, although I will admit I'm watching Vikings because I feel like it's ancestral history for me. The dudes have beards. The women are strong and mighty warriors with blonde hair. I'm a sucker for it. But I'm not a TV watcher. My eyes are too fatigued to read my heroes. You know, I've got my books. I brought Kerouac's Big Sur, which is an interesting book because it deals with his challenges after he became famous and his misgivings about, okay, I'm going to go hide out in Big Sur and avoid all the chaos and just hide out and restore and replenish my soul. And it went terribly wrong for him. I've been reading this book that I got from my dear therapist that I really should send a text to because she probably doesn't know where I am. One thing a day to become a Buddha brain, you know, and it's all great advice and it's things that I know, but I try to meditate and think on those things. And then a book that was so important to me that every young writer should read, Letters to a Young Poet by Rainier Maria Rilke. I've been thinking so much about old Gabriel Garcia Marquez, who just passed away, and his beautiful letter he wrote before he died, and how we write for our friends, man. We create. Those of us who have this thing that we write and we create, we do it for our friends. And my mom gave me this book by Mitch Albom, and it's easy to dismiss this as lightweight, and I haven't dug into it yet, but it means much to her, and my mom means so much to me, and without her right now, I'd be a bit of a mess. You know, I just had to escape Vancouver, because everywhere I looked was memories of my dad, memories of things I couldn't do. I look out my 18th floor apartment in the West End, since I moved from my beloved Lynn Valley, and I look out, and I see wonder, I see beauty, I see kayakers, and I see people on their bikes, and I think about going pitch and putting, and I think about going to other islands, and I think about adventure, and I think about just going across the False Creek to the Museum of Vancouver and the archives, because there's a dozen projects I want to work on with them, and the Maritime Museum with the St. Rock, the ship that was tried to make the Northwest Passage, and they were icebound for 2 years, and the Swedish man had to dive underwater to get them untangled. Such wonderful stories. The planetarium. But all of these things exhaust me. Doing anything but simply sitting and doing nothing exhausts me, right? And I've always lived, well, not always, but in my adult life, since reading Henry David Thoreau, I've always lived by only that day dawns to which we are awake. And I feel like I'm sleepwalking through life. And as I've been here, I'm in a town called Logan, Utah, which I swore I'd never return to after my grandpa died. But I'm making peace with it, right? I'm letting go of all kinds of old grudges, preconceptions, misconceptions, old hassles, forgiving everyone, forgiving everything. Even my old home suburb of Wally, which I always felt like I should have grown up somewhere else. My bonus son went there on a road trip with his baseball team. He pitches for a college team out of Washington State. And he pitched and won in Wally, blocks away where I sat 13 years old. I saw a punk rock show with DOA and the Spores and AOT that produced a picture that Bev Davies gave to me for my 40th birthday. It's like everything came around full circle. My beloved and my brother and their pals were there cheering them on. And everything seems to be going so great in so many ways, right, in my life. And I'm here in a safe place. When I needed to leave Vancouver, I thought about all sorts of things. Should I go on a cruise? No. Should I go on a meditation retreat? No, man, I can't be silent. I need love and affection from people. I need people to talk to. I need medical care. I need kindness. I need hugs. I don't need to be inside my own brain. I spend a lot of time inside my own brain right now. I thought about a tramp steamer steaming around the world, but I'm 75 years too late for that. The smaller ships, they're like, each day you'll be full of adventure, of kayaking and swimming with orcas and, you know, climbing glaciers. And it's hard enough for me to make my two poached eggs and steamed vegetables every morning, right? So here I am. And I feel like I'm doing so many things right. And so many people have given me kind advice. And even on my mom's refrigerator, you know, there's all these trite things. But I think, simplify. Yeah, I'm doing that, man. I'm imagining myself being healthy. I'm imagining all these things I'm going to do. My best work is in front of me. I've been sharing. I'm a natural sharer and a natural giver. But it's been almost a year. May 27th is when I got sick. That started me on this journey. And I've been pretty translucent after the first 3 or 4 months sharing what I've been going through. And part of this is to get advice from other people. Part of it is to get that little dopamine, serotonin, whatever it is, little hit that comes from the affection of receiving your kindness. My gratitude scrapbook, which I've shown you before, is so packed, right? And I look at it and sometimes I just think, I'm not worthy, right? Why are these people doing this? Why are you taking the time out of your day to write to me? And I sent out a batch, 50 some odd postcards, and last night when I couldn't sleep, I took all the photos I'd taken of those postcards, cropped them and uploaded them, just to do a project, right? To keep that virtuous circle going. The more I give, the more I receive, right? But I've also been hearing from people and from tarot cards to stop giving and just receive, just accept and let everything into your heart. And I'm working really hard on that. This book talks about that and just letting things into my heart. And it took a while for me to feel what that feels like, because I've always been someone who likes to make, likes to create, likes to give. Like Gabriel Garcia Marquez, I write for my friends, I create for my friends. I've been sharing obsessively. I've been digging into the rabbit holes of the internet to believe in it, in the goodness again. You know, there's so much commercialism and so much nonsense about algorithms and buy this and oh, how many clicks on your whatevers. You know, I've always said, fuck stats, make art. And I stand by that more than ever. And I find that there's more and more art and open culture on the internet as I've taken time to dig into it. Whether it be movies or museums putting their whole collections online, the British Gallery, more than 1 million images on Flickr, the Rijksmuseum, you can download high-resolution Van Goghs. This is all brilliant, beautiful things. It makes me believe that there's goodness out there. And I love it, right? And I want to do the same with the things that I create. But that's giving, and I have to receive, I have to slow down, I have to simplify. Simplify, slow down, simplify. Everyone tells me, from my doctors to my uncles, you know what you need to do, Dave, is nothing. But what does nothing look like? Do I just sit in a bed and do nothing? Well, then I sleep less. I don't watch TV. It's hard for me to read more than a couple pages at a time. On the computer, I have to use the accessibility options, and I'm using big text now, and it's kind of comical and cute. But what does doing nothing look like? Sitting out on the lawn, watching my variety of, you know, when you have second cousins, I've been calling myself a cousunk as I've been introducing myself. I'm sort of a cousin, I'm sort of an uncle, because I'm a natural uncle. And within an hour, I realize I share some sort of DNA with these kids, and they all think it's the funnest. I insist that they rub my beard for good luck. Oh, and I just accept their unabashed joy and exuberance, and I do my best to use my energy to play with them. Then I have to just go sit. And it's like I'm 43 going on 73, and that's not me. The world's ahead of me. There's so many people I'm following vicariously as they have wonderful success, traveling around the world, doing weird stuff, and I love it, right? I love it. So then it gets me excited about sharing the things that I've done, you know, stories of flash floods in Escalante Canyon, or putting all my videos from Jamaica, slowly getting those actually up online. And there's practical as well as personal reasons for doing that. One, I want to share the wonderful experience, and two, that, you know, I want to be in that community. I want to live parts of my life there, and I want you to come visit me there. Well, not all of you at once, but you get the idea, right? So, you know, and the tarot cards, you know, were saying you have to accept, right? You have to quit giving so much. Don't give so much. And let it all, let the abundance come in to your cups.
Well, as it turns out, at some point while I was recording, this little robot friend filled up and stopped recording, so I'm not sure what point I cut off. But what I'm going to tell you is I need to take the next steps, and I need advice from people who have been through this and come out the other side. I'm not sure if I told you about the lady from the hot springs, about the essential oils. In case I did, I won't go into it again. But and tapping on positive points. And my meditations are full of the future, and I'm visualizing myself not sick and being that Dave again. And that's one of the reasons I came down here, because it's down here in Utah that I biked all the major trails, went to every national park. I explored every corner with dear friends who took me under their wing and said, this is how you can live life. Strange that it happens in the strangest of places, if you look at it right. But I've also tried to consult with doctors and healers of different kinds here. You know, some of my cousins and relatives and so on, they'll be like, oh, I know this great doctor is an autoimmune specialist. He's a neuro-plasticity specialist and all this. I'm like, great, I'm ready for anything. World, I'm wide open for anything, for advice. And I hear messages from you about loving myself and about opening my heart and about eating healthy. And these things, I feel like I'm doing them well. You know, I've learned about meditation that it's not all about keeping the mind quiet. It's about pulling the mind back and pulling it back to the breath. And I'm great at visualizing myself. And I see myself with my little rucksack and traveling places. And I see myself sitting on a hill and sharing stories with other people. And I see myself with my books going on tours to share them to other people. I see myself in Jamaica with people coming to visit where I can teach what I've learned about writing poetry and about living life and about living deliberately. But the restorative sleep doesn't come. And then you start to get spiral down in depression. So much of my energy is pulling me back up from that spiral. And, you know, I go to cognitive behavioral therapy groups, and I learn these mindfulness techniques. Is this a valid thought? Is this a true thought? Come back, let it go, do less, make my list of what I want to accomplish that day, cut it in half and cut it in half again. I try to do one thing, one project, or if I go out with my mom, my two errand maximum, and I get as many hugs from people, and I just hold and hold and hold, and I don't let go. But if you have thoughts and advice or gurus or Svengalis that have a new perspective, because some of these doctors, the first thing they say is like, oh, look at these doses of medication you're taking. I'm like, great, I hate the medication. I really truly do. I'm a guy who loves to put organic good things into my body, but the medications, it's this crazy cocktail, right? And without them I don't sleep at all. With them I sleep fitfully and wake up and spend my day in a haze. I'm exhausted right now. I'm so tired, and the only thing I want to do is give and share, because One day I will be healed. I will come out the other end of this, and I will produce my finest works, and I will do wonderful things, and I will continue to give you hugs. Although one of my cousins yesterday said, I'm not a hugger, I'm a puncher. It was charming to say it to someone that you haven't seen in 15 years. But I let that go, right? Wow. No big deal, I don't care. But I'm going to continue to share, and I'm going to improve accepting. Because one of the reasons I give is because I know that you'll give back, and that gives me an opportunity to practice accepting joy and love and turning myself upside down to any kind of thing that you can throw at me. But keep in mind, I've done acupuncture, dried needle therapy, natural paths. I see a specialist who specializes in all this stuff. I've done the cognitive behavioral therapy. I've been to, and people are like, well, have you had a tube there, a tube there? And like, yes, I've done CAT scans, ultrasounds, MRIs, and endoscopies, colonoscopies. I've had, I'll save you the details. I've given so much blood. I walk in there and say, no, it's this vein right here will do you just fine. I've done it all. Probably 70 acupuncture treatments in the last couple of years. I drink the Chinese tea. I adjust my diet. I do food eliminations. Like, it's not like I'm not trying, right? And then I do meditations. And my dear friend from the CBT courses, the Buddhist, who also suffers from this struggle, she made recordings that I listen to every day, you know, to get in touch with my body and my breath and the ground. And I sit here and I look at the mountains, the snow-capped mountains, the Wellsvilles, in this town that I used to just, had so much anger. And I'm like, okay, I can love it here. I can love everything and everyone. I don't have the energy to do everything I want, not even close. But do I have energy to get out of bed and make a bit to eat and do putz around on a little project? Yeah, but I don't want that to be me forever. I mean, I love being in pajamas, and you probably noticed my new pair of pajamas. But the neighbors are probably wondering what the guy is doing out here at 2 in the afternoon in his pajamas. But I'm ready for the next steps. So what you got? I've poured out my heart to you, and I've shared all these videos that I made on the YouTubes now, so you can follow my whole healing journey from the week I got sick to today. And I need it for my own therapy, I think, but I also make it for the future. Because when I come out, I'll say, way to go, Dave, you did it, and other people will struggle with this, and they'll see my journey and say, look at what that guy went through, and he came out all right, right? To all of you who are following me along and sending me these things, I truly express my kindest love and thoughts. It really means the world to me. And I'll see you on the other side once I figure out who I'm going to be next. Because what I've realized is I'll never be the same Dave, but I'm going to be a Dave that's calm and disciplined and peaceful and thoughtful and has that spark that will return to me. I'll be different, and I'll like the old Dave because I watch a lot of them, and I watch these videos and things I've done. You know, this is what sometimes you find yourself in places you forgot. And I look at this Dave and go, who was that guy? But, I'm going to be a new Dave, and maybe you can help me figure out who I am. Thanks.